Cedar Park, Texas. Live, it's Timberwolf Night in America. This is the Mike Live Network of the night. More non-stop honking at the Cedar Park football horn. I'm the V of the T, voice of the Timberwolves, Brad Cohn. It's our second show of the season. 109th show overall in 8-plus seasons. We're live from our, well, I guess you might call it our next venue, Santa Catarina Mexican Restaurant on Cypress Creek Road, a few hundred yards west of old 183. I inhaled the Enchiladas Rancheros a little while ago. Excellent. We'll be here until 9 o'clock, so come on over and join us. We moved here because the previous venue would not allow us to use a big speaker so those gathered near us can hear the show. Santa Catarina will. So about 2 hours ago, I was packing equipment to come up here, and I can't find my dad-blammed power cable to that speaker, so here, you know, we're here to be able to use the speaker, and yet we have no speaker. Not tonight. That'll be rectified for next week's show. Usually with me, the king of laces out, the former whiteout, a member of our 2010 district championship team and regional finalists, Superman has pajamas with his logo. Sharks have a week dedicated to him. There ain't no bolder holder than my own personal Chris Collinsworth, lifetime Timberwolf Josh Willard. Josh is in a bit of a quandary. He's watching little Dakota, his two-year-old girl, waiting for his wife to get home from a late day of work she couldn't get out of. So he'll be joining us on the run, but isn't here quite yet. And Josh Cargile is our quality assurance agent tonight, closely and diligently monitoring the broadcast from the super secret, high-tech, low-maintenance, ultra-modern, technically advanced, stealthily cloaked Vipe Studios, making sure that we don't sound like 12 pounds of gravel tumbling in your dryer. With us tonight, our first player guests of the season, the Cedar Park defensive backs, and one of their coaches, Brendan McCarthy, who will be joined by a surprise coaching guest a little later, perhaps, the once and future DC, Brent Britton. We'll be having an extensive conversation with all those guys this evening, starting at the top of the hour. Remember, we will do this show every week in which we have a game. We take bye weeks off with the team. Every Tuesday night prior to a Friday or Thursday night game, Josh now will be broadcasting Timberwolf Night in America. This year's sponsors of the Booster Club and this show, Toyota of Cedar Park, HEB, Rudy's Barbecue, Mungia Real Estate, our touchdown sponsor, TJ Lewis Real Estate, Alzer's Barbecue, Army Ant Moving, Wofford Bank, and this here Santa Catarina Mexican Restaurant. They say it's more interior Mexico, not the Tex-Mex stuff that is popular around here, but I tell you, those enchiladas rancheros went down smooth. Here's what's on the menu for tonight's show. We're going to do the state of the program update. We're going to have a brief post-mortem on the season opener with Vandy. We'll take a look at other local scores of interest, some of the other teams we want to follow around here, our district and those around us. A walk through the wonderful world of Willard once Josh gets here. And then we'll bring on the DBs and Coach McCarthy. We'll play a little trivia game with the guys, and we're done talking with them. And then we'll preview Cedar Ridge, and then we'll put this thing to bed about 9 o'clock. All right, so here's our state of the program update. All-time record for Cedar Park football is now 202-72. We need to keep mindful of stuff like this, especially after suffering what we suffered through Friday night. Things are still pretty good around here overall. That's 130 games over 500. They're now 54-28 in regular season non-district games, most of those losses prior to 12 and 13 years ago. This program is 37-8 against all other LISD teams, and those losses are split evenly between two rivals, 4 to Leander and 4 to Vandegrift. Neither Vista Ridge, Rouse, nor Glenn have ever beaten Cedar Park. Program's now 107-46 away from home. Cedar Park's record while playing as a top 10 ranked team is 92-16. 92-16 when we play as a top 10 ranked team. Against 6A teams, while playing as a 5A team, which has been all of our non-district schedule for about the last dozen years, Cedar Park is 25-8. And we don't schedule the Sisters of the Poor. It's not Aikens that we schedule as a 6A team. You know, it's often ranked 6A teams, district champion 6A teams, state champion 6A teams. Each of these are categories that have added a loss, unfortunately, after the defeat to Vandy last week. But as you can see, in every one of those categories, Timberwolf football still massively leads the opposition. All right, unfortunately, now we have to do my very least favorite thing to do on this show. That's looking back at a loss. Okay, let me wet my whistle with some tea here. Ah, restaurant quality iced tea. Now, we're not going to ignore things and just sweep stuff under a rug and pretend bad things never happened because it's too comfortable to talk or even think about it. That's what lesser programs do. That's part of what makes them lesser programs. If we can't trot out the bad stuff for sober examination analysis, might as well get involved in something else because life is like that. Bad things do happen in every aspect of life. And ignoring them because they're uncomfortable is the path to the dark side. So if you can't do this, good luck at other more important aspects of life in the future. You got to be willing to look at and learn from the bad stuff to get back on the path to the good stuff. Team, the coaches did this all weekend. They've moved past it, but this is our first chance as fans and the covers of the team to hit it. We got to get it behind us. It's going to hurt. It's going to hurt like peeling back a scab that's not wanting to come off. So take a deep breath, bite down on a stick, and here we go. 42-7 was the worst ever opening night loss in program history, coming consecutively after the worst ever loss of any kind in program history in the 2020 state championship game. And weirdly, despite the true fact that this is a very good football program with phenomenal records, sliced and diced a number of different ways, all across all categories, there's an aberration in our record through the years that's engaged right now. Due to our tough non-district scheduling, that wouldn't have it any other way. It's a way to go. But due to that and the fact that most playoff campaigns will end in a loss, 11 times in 23 seasons now, we have suffered widely separated consecutive defeats by ending one season with a playoff loss and beginning the next with a season-opening defeat to a tough 6A team. But I can find a silver lining here, because that means that 22 of the program's grand total of 72 losses all time, that's 31% of all program losses ever, have occurred this way. And that is pretty impressive. But the average margin of defeat in the other times over the years that Cedar Park has suffered consecutive losses is just 9 points over those pairs of games. For these most recent two losses, the average margin is 40. In these two games, we've been outscored by 80 points and have given up just under 1,000 yards of offense and 50 first downs. We have never led, and this is only the third time in program history that we have spanned two games and never held a lead. If you're wondering whether we've ever lost more than two games in a row, unfortunately, yeah, we have. We've lost three in a row 7 times, but only once in the last 10 years, spanning the 17 and 18 seasons. We've lost four in a row once, way back in 03, and the ignominious school record is 5 straight defeats in 2002, the very next year. In both of those seasons, we went 3-7, and 2003 was the last losing season at Cedar Park. I keep the 149-page school record book and my weekly updates of it after a game. Usually see many entries in various categories. This guy had the 5th most receiving yards ever, or the team had the 3rd best passing night ever, or the 2nd most sacks ever, or whatever. After this game, there's only one item that qualified for the book in a positive light. Even then, there's a little touch of morbidity. The team set a new record for the most players to catch a pass in a loss. It was 8 guys. There were several marks that went into the book on the unwelcome side of the ledger, but again, we're required to look at them unless we're only pretending to be serious about all this. Vandy's 445 yards of total offense is the 14th most ever allowed by a CP defense. Vandy's 249 passing yards are the 26th most ever allowed by a CP defense. Reese Beauchamp's 3 touchdown catches are the most ever in one game against a Cedar Park defense. The 5 Cedar Park turnovers tied 3 other performances for their most ever in one game. This is the first game without a true sack in 4 years. There was a 19-yard loss chasing their holder after a bad field goal snap. It wasn't really a sack. This is only the 18th time in Cedar Park history, that's 274 games, that the T-Wolves' point total was a single digit. Josh Pell twice completed passes over the middle for 17 and 16 yards for first downs, and then the ball was fumbled away. And Vandy struck quickly afterward with touchdown passes almost immediately thereafter. In a matter of moments, we went from tied nothing to nothing and moving the ball better than they were to staring at the wrong end of the famous unmentionable stat, trailing 14 to nothing. And lastly, this game ended a 17-game regular season winning streak that started in 2019. And ironically, the last regular season loss was the 2019 opener on the road at Vandy. So, there, we did it. The scab is off. Take the sticks out of your mouths. I don't ever want to talk about these things again after tonight. If you come up to me later and you say, what was that one thing you said about Sacks, or how many times is it we lost the season opener, I will not answer you. We did our due diligence tonight and trotted these things out because we're bound by honor and self-respect to do so, but we don't have to like it, and we don't have to do it again. After this segment of this show, we move on. Team already has, like we said. But there were some things to like in this game. Josh Pell had a pretty good first start at quarterback. He went 16 for 30 with two picks for 140 yards, spreading the biscuit around to eight different guys, seven of them making their first career varsity catches. Pell also ran for a touchdown and made good decisions about when to run. Tyree Nicholson got the start at running back. Kevin Adams is banged up. Tyree looked strong, running for 76 yards, most of that after contact. He had long runs of 9, 10, and 15 yards. Houston Molinaro had some good catches, 3 for 8, 11, and 17 yards. Nick Grulon led receivers with 4 snatches for 37 yards. Cody Marshall came up with a pick, and we'll maybe get to talk to him about that one shortly, if he wants to bring it up. On defense, on 23 out of 66 of their plays, that was about a third of them, we held them to 1-0 or negative yardage. Nearly a third of their plays going nowhere or backwards. Vandy got 196 yards rushing, but 72 of that came on 3 of their 39 carries. So 37% of their rushing yards came on 8% of their rushing plays. The Vipers threw for 249, but a stunning 187 of that came on their 5 touchdown passes. So 75% of their passing yards came on 18% of their passing plays. That means a grand total of 58% of their total offense came from 8 of their 66 plays. That's 58% of their yardage from 12% of their plays. Clearly, for most of the night, the defense did all right. Just need to plug the holes that gave up those 8 big plays. All right, now let's take a look at some of the other local scores of interest from last week. In our league, 11-5A, Georgetown lost to 6A Belton 35-31. Leander beat Glenn in one of the 3 battles for Bible. Leander and Glenn do that. Leander and Rouse do that. Rouse and Glenn do that. They all split that stadium. Leander beat Glenn 20-17. Hendrickson fell to a good 6A team, Siebel of Steel, 35-14. Weiss, who Texas football picked to finish second in our league, they got the most experience back, it's true. They fell, though, to Harker Heights, 43-35. Harker Heights isn't supposed to be anything special. Pflugerville over Laredo United, 22-14. McCallum beat the Anderson Trojans. Those two have been arch rivals since the early 70s. That one was 14-13 Knights. And then our Maynard Mustangs from our league lost to LBJ 28-7. So Leander and Pflugerville are the only 11-5A teams to win their openers. That's rare. We're usually in a league that will go through 3 non-district games on all their 7 teams, 21 games, and we'll probably go 17-4. But only 2 of the 7 won this last week, so we're 2-5. Here's some other neat scores to look at. Red Oak fell to Ennis 56-42. That's Coach Q's former team. They fell in that one. Katie Pato, who we didn't play in, I guess it was the second round last year of the playoffs because they had a COVID experience, and so somebody else moved in. We were going to play Katie Pato and didn't. Guess who they played to open the season? Barbers Hill. That sounds familiar. Where Carl Abseck went. Carl lost to the Katie Pato, 41-20, so he starts his next job off with a stumble. Tyler Legacy, which is Joe Willis's team, after moving there from Colleyville Heritage, they beat Lufkin, a perennial top program, 35-17. Brad Willard, Josh's brother, who's only a year older than Josh and is the youngest high school head coach in this greatest state of all for high school football. Brad Willard, head coach at Mount Vernon, starts his career off hot. First career game at the helm of a program, beat Hooks. Yeah, that's where Billy Sims went, Heisman Trophy winner from Oklahoma. Beat Hooks 63-18. Congratulations to Brad Willard, our former fullback. Josh Mann opens with a win, our former defensive coordinator. He's the head man at Rouse, only coach they've ever had. They beat Burnett 44-7. Burnett is a 4A team. Lovejoy, that's where Chris Ross is right now. He's got a win out of the gate over Brian, the Vikings. He's not 6A, and they are, and he beat them 44-14. That's what we usually do to 6A teams. And Liberty Hill right up the road fell to Colleen Ellison 12-7. And to me, that's a surprise. Ellison's not supposed to be anything special. Aikens beat Elgin 27-0. Dripping Springs over Kerrville Tyvee 44-26. Lake Travis, the Cavalier, over Arlington Martin 40-28. Cedar Ridge, our next opponent, over Colleen. Colleen's not special either. 45-14. So they're our next opponent. They start out 1-0. Bowie over Vista Ridge, the other Cedar Park, 17-7, and that's Austin Bowie, not the town of Bowie. Westlake emptied a can of whoop-ass on Temple, 54-13. Usually a strong program, and they fell big to the Chaps. And here's one. This isn't a surprise to me as a win. The margin is a surprise to me. Waco Midway's a top program across the state, has been for years. Played them twice in the regular season a couple years ago, won one and lost one. They've been in the state championship games a couple of times. They played Round Rock, and Round Rock won 69-17. They're our next week opponent. And then Eastview over Westwood, 41-14. And, of course, the big news, North Dallas canceled their road game at Venus. No one could figure out how to go 26 million miles and land in that heavy atmosphere. The people at Venus were crushed. God, I don't have my rim shot here to play. This is where we normally go off to see the Willard, the wonderful Willard of Oz. Another fascinating voyage to the wonderful world of Willard. Josh is not here right now, so we're going to take our break early and come back and get to the guys, the DBs, and Coach Brendan McCarthy a little bit early, too. You are listening to Timberwolf Night in America on the Vipe Live Network.
Been involved in Cedar Park sports for years, just as Alzer's Barbecue has been involved in Cedar Park cuisine for years. It's one-of-a-kind, authentic Texas barbecue. Brisket, turkey, chicken, lamb, terrific sides and sauces. It's sheer succulence. That's Alzer's Barbecue, next to the Shell Station on 1431, just east of Lakeline. Open Friday through Sunday, every weekend.
Experience the difference at Toyota of Cedar Park, one of the Austin area's newest automobile dealerships. Their new vehicle department will always stock the newest Toyota models you need. The pre-owned vehicles they choose must each pass a rigorous inspection and be in tip-top shape before they make it to their lot or website for you to see. And if you're looking for budget-friendly Toyota-certified used vehicles, they've got you covered, and you can rest easy knowing that the best new cars make the best used cars. That's Toyota of Cedar Park at toyotaofcedarpark.com.
In the battle for barbecue supremacy, Warriors Pit Prime meets secret sauces and recipes against one another. Yet one champion stands alone. Rudy's Country Store and Barbecue, in the modern day vernacular, where bad means good. Rudy's Country Store and Barbecue has the worst barbecue in Texas.
A premier real estate brokerage in Central Texas, Mungia Real Estate's innovative buy-sell process results in their listings selling faster than the Austin average. Their attention to clients sets Mungia apart from other brokerages with creative marketing strategies, savvy negotiation skills, and a commitment to hard work and excellent customer service. Whether it's residential, single-family, multifamily, condos, commercial, or vacant land, Mungia Real Estate knows the Austin market and connects buyers with sellers every day. And they do it with professionalism. Mungia Real Estate at 512-922-4267 or mungiarealestate.com. That's M-U-N-G-I-A.
At WaFed Bank, formerly Washington Federal, working together isn't new for us. We've been awarded America's Best Big Bank by Newsweek. From digital options, touchless transactions, and increased nonprofit contributions to help our neighbors, we're here for you. Our bankers approved more than 9,000 PPP loans to keep small businesses going during the pandemic. WaFed Bank is a local bank and portfolio lender with more than 200 branches in 8 states to serve you. 24/7 online and mobile banking with mobile check deposits, over 32,000 ATMs, free checking. WaFed Bank, your local bank for personal and business banking at wafedbank.com or 800-324-9375.
Army Ant Moving calls Cedar Park home for movers that residents and businesses can rely on. For outstanding moving expertise and trustworthy estimates, Army Ant Moving stands above the rest. Their reputation speaks for itself. They've received the Angie's List Superior Service Award for the last 2 years. Their movers are highly trained and experienced. So whether you need to move your household to a new home across town or an entire corporate office to a new location, your valuables are in knowledgeable and reliable hands with Army Ant Moving Company. Check them out at armyantmoving.com.
Welcome back. Timberwolf Night in America, live on the Mike Network, episode 2 for 2021, live from Santa Catarina on Cypress Creek Road here in Cedar Park, our second new venue of the season, and we hope to be staying here. Brad Cohn here, would be joined by Josh Willard normally. He's running a little late, plans to be here though. Josh Cargile, our QA tonight. Thanks, Josh, here on the Vipe Live Network. And now, our special guests tonight, the defensive backs. And we invited all three of our coaches. Only one took us up on it. And he's a new coach of staff, Brendan McCarthy. Brendan, go ahead and take that. Let me turn this up for you. Okay, go ahead and talk in it for me.
Hello.
All right, there you go. That sounds good. Brendan came over from the middle school program. He'd been running the very successful Cedar Park Middle School Leopards for a number of years. How many years were you running that?
I was there for 13 years.
13? Wow. Yes, sir. Did a heck of a job feeding this program, working with these coaches. I know you go scouting every Friday night for them and work with us on the playoffs. And it was a long overdue promotion, I think, to get you on the staff.
Well, I don't know. It had been something in the back of my mind for a while, you know. And then, you know, when the whole Coach Abtec movement and the whole change came about, and I knew Coach Q when he was here originally, and Coach Britton, which I'm really good friends with, and I found out that they were coming back and had just had the conversation and really prayed about it and felt like the Lord said it was time to make that move.
Well, good, good. So, and you didn't even have to move. You know, I mean,
I didn't
sell a house or anything.
I didn't have to do any of that. So that was kind of a nice plus, I guess.
So you're one of a few guys doing defensive back coaching. And
yes, sir.
What are your specific duties with the DBs?
The safeties.
Okay.
So I'm working with the safeties. I work with these four right here, Luke, Cody, and Dylan.
Okay.
We have another coach, Coach Poole, who helps with the safeties, and we got Coach Woko, who
he does the corners.
He does the corners, and Coach Britton also is kind of jack of all trades, DC, kind of doing everything. So appreciate him.
Coach Britton is the one that might be joining us a little bit later as well. It's great to have him back. You know, you were around here when he was the defensive coordinator.
Yes.
He's the best one we ever had.
I agree, and that's why I thought, you know, if I was going to make that move, now this is the time to do it. And so it's been a learning curve for me, you know, obviously.
Sure.
Going from there to up to varsity, but it's been fun with these guys. He's a great bunch of guys, so couldn't ask for better guys.
Fans, if you think about a 7th or 8th grade player suddenly going to the varsity football team at the high school and all the differences in how everything is done, that's what Brent McCarthy's kind of going through too, is everything's done differently at a different pace and a different
manner.
And yeah. And longer games.
Yeah, a little longer, a little bit faster.
A little bit faster pace.
So, yeah. But it's been pretty fun because I had all these guys.
Yeah.
You know, back in there.
You already know a lot about them.
So I already knew about them. So
and they know a lot about you.
Yeah, so I was excited. I don't know how excited they were. I don't know. Having me coming up, but it was fun.
That happened to me when I was in junior high. We had a brand new coach, got his first job as the 7th grade coach when I was in 7th grade. And he was a good coach. We never lost. Rarely got scored on, but he was an ass. He was like a reprehensible human being.
Oh, no.
I mean, we respect him as a coach, but oh my God, what a dude. Oh my God, no. You know, you don't want your,
yeah.
You know, if your mom's single and you're going to get a stepdad, you don't want her to meet this guy.
I know.
Anyway, this guy's, I'll give the name because I'm sure he's not listening. His name was Cornelius L. Hocker, and the L, his middle name was Lucifer.
Oh, there you go.
So he's named after Satan and throat phlegm. You know,
right? It goes hand in hand with him, I guess.
Oh my God! But he was a great football coach, and we never lost.
And then so I go to eighth grade the next year, and he did such a great job there. The school district promoted him, and he coached the eighth grade team the next year. Okay, well, we're going to win a lot, but oh, my God, he's going to beat our butts.
That's fine.
And he did, and we did. And so we go to high school. And so since he was undefeated as a junior high coach and there was an opening on our high school staff, they promoted him to high school. And in ninth grade, he got the job coaching the ninth grade team. So he was my coach again 3 years.
Oh, man.
So next year, I was a pretty good strong safety, and I got to go up to the varsity. And our defensive backs coach, well, our secondary coach was a guy who's in the High School Football Hall of Fame now, Ron Schrader, who coached Westlake to their only state title until these last two.
Yes, I remember him.
He was our defensive backs coach when I was in high school, before he went to Westlake, before he was ever a head coach. But my position coach, a safeties coach, was Hawker. So basically, I had him for 4 years. Then I blew a knee and had to quit football. Here, go behind me, Josh. Yeah! You're not going to hear me say that twice. Josh has arrived now. And we started, since we didn't have you, we went a little bit early over to talk to Coach McCarthy. So what we're going to do is, once we're done talking with Brendan here for a second, we'll let you do your wonderful World of Willard. Then we'll come back to the guys, because that puts us on schedule. We're a little bit early. So one thing I want to do is, since you're a new coach to a fan base and they may not know much about you, on the other hand, they may know you well if their kids are at the middle schools. But anyway, let's do this. Tell folks, you know, where are you from, where'd you grow up, what high school, what college, what position you played,
okay,
other coaching stops before you were here in Cedar Park.
All right, well, I grew up in a smaller town northwest in Arizona called Kingman.
I've been through it.
You probably have. You've driven through. If you've driven through to Vegas, you've driven through Kingman. May have gotten a speeding ticket there, because a lot of people have. Yep. But I grew up there, graduated in 85, and then I played, in high school, I played football, basketball, and baseball. I was quarterback, and up until varsity, I was quarterback and safeties, and then just obviously just went straight quarterback once I got to varsity. And then after that, I went to Scottsdale Community College, where I played quarterback there. For two seasons, and then I went on to Arizona State, and played there for a little bit. And
what
didn't
years
didn't
were
play,
you at Arizona State?
I was there in 87. I was 87 through, and graduated in 92. So
yeah,
it took me a little while.
Hey, you know? I was on the 6-year plan at UT myself.
Yeah.
Had to change majors halfway through.
So
who was the quarterback at Arizona State when you were there?
When I was there, Jeff Van Rapport's just finished, and then, to be honest with you, me, this guy named Paul Justin, Jeff Ford, and that was kind of the three there. And then Paul Justin, in fact, he ended up getting the job, and I think he ended up being on the Cowboys for a little bit. I don't think he started.
Had another Arizona State quarterback there, Danny White.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so he was there. So then after that, I was coaching a place called Apache Junction out there, high school.
Yeah.
So I
heard
started
them too.
Coach them, and then it's a long story. My wife could tell the story a whole lot better than I can. But we ended up coming out here visiting. She visited her dad. We actually came out of church, and she felt like the need to come talk to her dad out here. Her dad was living in Round Rock or Georgetown at the time. And she came out, had a good visit, went back, and I just asked her, said, hey, is this a place that, you know, you want to move or we can come out to? And she said, yeah. So we came out and visited, took a look around, and I don't remember exactly, but somehow I ended up talking to Kelly Reeves.
Oh.
And he said, hey, I got a position open up at Hopewell Middle School.
Uh-huh.
And I took it.
Anything in the area,
anything. So I took that position, and that was in 2001. That's when we moved out here in 2001. And I did. I enjoyed it. And I was there for about five years, I believe, and then I think it was in 2006 is when I came over to Cedar Park. And then
now, did you buy a house in Round Rock and then move to Cedar Park when you
So we had a house in Round Rock, and then we decided to come to Cedar Park. I think we rented for about a year, and then purchased our home there. And so
in 2006 or 7, you bought a house?
Yes, sir.
You're going to be rich someday.
I know. We're staying put right now. Uh-huh. We love the neighborhood. We love being there at Cedar Park, and so I'm hoping that this will be my last stop. And
me too. I like coaching stability. I hope you stay here the rest of your career.
So it's been fun so far. So,
all right. Well, that's Brendan McCarthy, the safeties coach of the DBs. We're going to talk to the DBs here in a minute, but first, Josh is here. Josh, I already introduced you in absentia, so welcome to the show tonight.
Thank you so much. You know, it took me a little bit of time to get over here. A little miscommunication on the home front with the wife and baby duties.
You're going to have to claim it was your fault, though. You know that,
100%.
Right?
Yeah. I'll get out in front of it right now. I'm actually, you know, publicly getting out in front of it so I can take this film back to the wife tonight when we break it down. So, you know, very, very sorry to be late, but excited to be here. Man, where do I go from here? You lead me off. I mean, what do you need?
We're gonna go see the Willard, the wonderful World of
Oz. We're going straight into that.
Wonderful World of Willard.
Well, then let's go aboard. Well, Brad, it was a crazy last week. We had the kickoff of college football. Let's see, we get you turned up a little bit there.
Oh, I just said yeah?
Yeah. Fresno State had their first home game playing in California. The on-field temperature for that game was 135 degrees.
Oh, my God.
They had to delay the game so it could get a little bit cooler. Just absolutely insane. Players' cleats.
No, that's like the San Fernando Valley or something.
Players' cleats were actually melting on the field. So just a wild scene in college football right out of the gate. Also, I just wanted to go ahead and touch on my brother.
His
first year as a head coach up at Mount Vernon. I'm repping the Mount Vernon Tigers right now. He got a 63-18 victory over you-know-who. Other guy.
I said it earlier.
Yeah. But really, really excited for my brother. Let's see, over Hooks.
Billy Sims' alma mater.
It's like 20 minutes away from Arkansas.
Yeah.
Absolutely insane, but really excited for my brother and that opportunity coming from that Coach Ross tree. So many coaches coming from that, you know, tree per se.
Yeah.
And so really excited for Brad to be in that position, taking over for Art Briles at Mount Vernon.
The alma mater of Dandy Don Meredith.
Really?
Yeah.
Who would have thunk? Let's see. And then also I wanted to touch on, did you hear about how ESPN was duped this past weekend for high school football?
No, I didn't.
Oh, this is a great one, Brad. Bishop Sycamore is a high school that was playing IMG Academy out of Florida. Bishop Sycamore is located in Columbus, Ohio. I'm doing air quotes for people that can't hear me, see me right now, because it was a false school.
Oh.
Bishop Sycamore is an online school and is not a high school program. Their roster consists of 19 and 20-year-old ex-JUCO players that have actually played JUCO games.
And so they want to trade their wares up against a high school program.
And their head coach has a warrant out for his arrest.
Not necessarily for this, but for other things?
Yes, it actually is for another thing. But TexasFootball.com put out a great article. I just wanted to read a snippet.
Okay.
Bishop Sycamore claimed to be a high school based in Columbus, Ohio, but no evidence supporting information exists to verify that claim. From the opening kickoff, Bishop Sycamore was not on the same skill level as IMG, the number 2 ranked team in the country, according to Max Preps. Bishop Sycamore boasted that its roster was filled with D1 talent. That clearly was not the case after 6 minutes elapsed in the second quarter with the Bishop Sycamore down 30-0.
That's the final
final score was 58-0 in the favor of IMG Academy. And the names on the Sycamore roster could not be verified in any recruiting listings or services. A proper vetting process would include research into the coaching staff, cross-checking players with recruiting rankings, looking at the previous schedules played, and the current season's strength of schedule. Bishop Sycamore has multiple games scheduled against other powerhouse programs this year, including Duncanville. Oh, and they played a game on Friday night, just 2 days prior to the game that was broadcasted on ESPN Live. Several players in the game against IMG played in that game 2 days prior, which is another,
against most states' rules.
Yes.
Another thing that's against most states' rules is you have to be a teenager to participate in high school ball.
Well, that's
and I bet you a lot of those guys are in their 20s.
You have adults playing against minors, and, I mean, that's...
When I was a sophomore in high school, our quarterback for the Mighty Vikings was Al Mowdy. He was awful. He's a good running quarterback. I'm not sure he was right-handed watching him throw. He only got to play the first half of the season because somewhere in October he turned 20.
Oh, my gosh.
That's how stupid he was.
Whoa.
He failed fifth grade twice or something like that.
Yeah, that'll do it for you. So that was just a wild story that took place. And, I mean, ESPN even getting fooled into broadcasting this game. It kind of looks bad on their part. But just a wild scene that, I mean, they have so many big games scheduled this year, and I wonder if that'll, if Duncanville will get a new game on that schedule.
I bet you.
Finally, what I got in store for you for Stupid Is or Stupid Does, in that college football kickoff weekend, oh, before we get to that, Brad, I have to pay homage to the best quarterback ever got cut today.
Who's that?
My favorite player as a Carolina Panthers fan.
Tom Brady got cut?
Cam Newton.
Oh, yeah.
Cam Newton got cut by the Patriots, and I've been in my feelings all day. But it's okay. He'll land on another roster.
Yeah, I think that Bishop Sycamore team.
Oh, come on, Brad. Oh, goodness. Well, let's just get right to the stupid is a stupid does then. Finally going into the for this last weekend of college football, a great slate of games. Not really. We had Hawaii, UCLA. That's a good one. But Nebraska and Illinois.
I saw that game.
That's a pretty good game. That's
should be.
And Nebraska lost Scott Frost? I mean, it's not even at the end of August, and he's already on the hot seat.
He's on the hot seat with the NCAA, too, that for some violations.
That's okay. Everybody's doing violations. But Scott Frost, you got to figure it out because you're on the tightrope, buddy.
Are you stupid or something?
Honestly, as stupid as a stupid does.
I heard that Forrest Gump's password is one Forrest one.
Oh, that's a good one. That's a good dad. That's a good dad joke to put in the arsenal.
I didn't get the rim shot up. I've missed a couple.
I need to get that ready.
All right. So now we're back on schedule and we're ready to talk to the defensive backs. We'll go here first. Every guy who's going to talk will just kind of move musical chairs and move up and put them here so you're next to the microphone. Now, I can barely see you. I'm not sure. I know the names. I know who you are, but you're down, way down on the field underneath helmets. So I don't recognize faces very well. So tell everybody name, number, and position before we go.
So my name is, wait.
Let's turn it
go
up.
Go ahead.
Okay, go.
My name is Dylan Rogers. I'm a safety.
Into the mic.
My name is Dylan Rogers. Safety, and I wear number 23.
Nice.
Dylan Rogers, safety 23. There we go. So, Dylan, what class are you?
I'm a senior, so the class of 22.
Senior. Were you on varsity last year?
I was not, no.
So, played a lot on the JV team.
Yes, sir.
A lot of good action there. Won most of the games. Our JV program is good. Got you some playing time to get you ready for this. Describe for folks who have never done it the difference. What kind of differences do you see that just are clear differences between a season on the JV and playing on the varsity?
A lot of it is the energy from the stands and the fans.
The band playing.
Yeah. The energy's crazy, and the tempo. It's a lot more fast-paced and more energetic on the field.
So did you get some good snaps playing time Friday night?
Yeah, I got about 30 snaps.
Good.
Yeah.
Did it make any plays?
I had 7 tackles. I had a forced fumble and a pass breakup. So,
there you go. Yeah.
On the other hand, I don't like our safeties making a lot of tackles.
That's a different story.
That was probably an 11-yard game.
That's a different story.
Yeah. We didn't like that much. So Coach McCarthy here is a safety. He's your position coach.
Yes, sir.
What kind of things does he do to help you get to be a better player week in, week out?
He's very He's good at coaching. You know, he's kind of calm, like, so he's not, like, yelling at us, and it helps us, like, learn instead of, like, a coach just, like, yelling at you. So it's easier to understand what he's saying and what he's trying to teach us and stuff.
I had a coach that just vibrated your earwax.
Yeah, so it's very helpful to have someone just, like, one that we know very well because he was a middle school coach for us 6 or 7 years ago. Yeah, we have a good connection with him, and he's a good coach.
I'm going to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Among the defensive backs.
Yes, sir.
Who is the funniest one?
It's got to be Dylan Hufford.
Dylan Hufford, ooh, the funniest one?
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, when we get to him, we'll put him on display for everybody.
All right.
All right. What do you plan on doing when you're done with high school?
My goal is to go to Texas Tech and major in some sort of engineering field, but I'm not quite sure which one yet.
Go to Lubbock? Do you have a family there? Mom or dad went there or anything? Why'd you choose Tech?
I originally had no interest in going to Tech, but my sister she got accepted into the school last year. It just sparked some interest in me, and they have a good engineering program. So it's my go-to right now.
And you found out you like tortillas.
Yeah.
There you go.
All right. Give your name, number, and position again.
My name is Dylan Rogers. I'm a safety, and I wear number 23.
All right. And let's pass it, scoot everybody up one, and we'll go to the next guy. We're talking with a defensive back tonight. It was Dylan Rogers, a senior safety. All right. Name, rank, and serial number. Or name, position, and number.
Hello, my name is Dylan Hufford. I wear number 9, and I am a DB, so a safety.
And he's a comedian.
That's right.
So why would he say that you're the funniest guy there? What is it that you do that cracks people up?
I would say I just find the light in situations. We could be having like a kind of down practice, and I'll just be like kind of joking around, trying to lift everybody up.
Timing for a comedian is everything.
Yeah.
So if you could definitely break the ice on that defensive side, because as a wide receiver, I mean, I don't like how tense you guys get. So if you could break the ice, that's good.
Yeah, he's an old wide receiver.
I'm glad they got one on their side.
What's your favorite thing to do in football? What lights your fire? Why do you play football?
I mainly play football because, you know, just being with my teammates and like friends I've been growing up with, it's just kind of like a fun thing to do. So I really like bonding with my teammates.
You know, that's kind of more of a guy thing than a girl thing. Right. Not exclusively a guy thing. But I tell you, when I talk about that aspect of it with my wife, she doesn't get it.
Yeah.
You know, she'll acknowledge it. Hey, listen, oh, yeah, teamwork, yeah, you like your team. But she doesn't understand how deep that is.
She still doesn't get it?
She still doesn't get it.
Oh, gosh, I'm only on year one.
You know,
I thought she would understand eventually.
No, well, maybe she will. Mine did, but mine didn't play sports or anything. It didn't do something where you're a part of a team. But there's some sort of deep core psychological, emotional satisfaction at getting with some guys with a goal and working together and helping each other do it and getting it done.
Right.
It's just something that lives with you. You'll remember these guys the rest of your life.
Yeah.
You really will. Well, I played football, as I've told Josh many times, so that I could do things to people that I'd get arrested for at the stadium. And as a safety, you get to do that.
Right.
What's your greatest hit ever?
Shoot, I would say, honestly, last game on the first play of a kickoff return, I kind of lit somebody up. So,
all right.
Yeah, that felt really nice.
All right. Oh, it does feel good. It does feel good. Josh here is one of the guys who was getting lit up by people like
that. Dude.
He doesn't see that as much.
Dude. No. I mean, in order to play receiver at Cedar Park, you had to come lay the wood.
That's true.
Right.
I would lay the freaking wood out there, dude. Set that perimeter.
Yeah.
Now, you got anybody you want to shout out to?
I would just say shout out my family and shout out my teammates.
And give the mic to Dylan for a second, the first Dylan, because I forgot to ask you that. Anybody shout out for Dylan Rogers?
My shout out would be the Black Rain, the troop, and my family as well.
All right, there we go. Dylan. So Rogers and Hufford, now we're going to slide the musical Mexican restaurant chairs again. And slide the next guy in.
Cody.
All right. Oh, yeah, we know this guy. Tell everybody who you are and your position, your number.
My name is Cody Marshall. I play safety, and I wear number 1.
and in your heart.
Number one. Now, did you try for number one or just work out that way? Did you want number one?
Oh, yeah. I've been number one, like, most of my life since I lived in California. So, you know.
Did you have to pay off three other guys who'd also been number one all their life or anything like that?
No, I just got lucky last year with it, junior year. I didn't think I was going to get number one, but I just got lucky and landed with it. So I had it all 4 years.
Now, we've called his name a lot the last couple of
years. Oh, come on now. Come on now. You already know. So, Cody, I mean, you've been having a great off season preparing for your senior year and coming off of that state championship. I know you've definitely been working hard just getting right after it. Is there a particular safety or defensive back that you try to work after or emulate your game after?
You know, last year Blake Byrne was a real big influence on my game. He was like one of the best leaders I've ever played with, and you know, just like I want to go out there and play like him. He gave it all he had every single snap, and you know, he was a dog out there. He just did the job so good. So mm-hmm.
The landlord.
Yeah, 120 yard landlord.
So what is your favorite thing to do as a football player? What lights your fire in this sport?
You know, just being around, you know, like the atmosphere during the game and just making plays happen. There's nothing that feels more exciting than being out there on Friday nights under all those lights, the whole crowd cheering loud, and you know that they're behind you and making good plays. So, yeah.
You know, for most of us playing high school football, especially in Texas where it's the best in the country, it's probably the highest form of athletics we'll ever get to play in our lives. Only a few go on to the next level. And, again, you know, you guys are going to remember this forever. You remember, I don't care that we lost, you remember that you were at Jerry World, at the Death Star, playing for the state championship last year. Tell me about the kind of jitters you kind of get when you're walking into that place before a game like that.
Yeah, the first time I actually walked into the stadium for warm-ups, I mean, it just, you don't realize how big the stadium is and how bright the lights are until you get under them. So, you know, that was like the first thing that really caught my eye was how bright the lights were, how big the stands were. And I was just, you know, feeling nervous for how many people were going to be there. But, you know, once the game came, it just, all the nerves went away. I was just playing football.
I always just hope the players never find out how heavy the scoreboard is.
Yes. I do have a bone to pick with Mr. Marshall. So I actually, this is my 10-year anniversary from graduating from Cedar Park this year. And I played slot, probably the best ever. actually, I was the best extra point and field goal holder in history, and I will tell it to Kruger's face every single time because he ain't getting by this. But you've already logged more catches this year than I did in my career. What's the deal, man?
You know, they play me.
You play defense, dude. Pick a side.
Yeah, we were a little surprised.
Come on, man. Pick a side. What's the problem, bro? What's the problem?
You know, I played wide receiver like my whole life, and you know, I just stepped up into the safety role. And knowing my abilities, they like to play me both ways because you know it's just giving us the best opportunity to win. But I don't know, man. I think Cole Kruger's got that spot for holder on lock.
Uh oh.
I can't go against my boy Cole Kruger.
These boys are young.
You have to do some work.
Forgive them, for they do not know.
All right, Cody, I'm gonna ask you this important question. Among the defensive backs, who's the best singer?
The best singer, huh? I would have to go with George Wheeler.
George Wheeler,
the best singer.
Okay.
Nice.
Yep.
Cue up some.
He's got a beautiful voice.
Yeah. I got some Bruno Mars.
George Wheeler's the best singer. All right, anybody want to give a shout-out to?
Shout-out Connor Mason. Shout-out Coach Bam. Shout-out Blake Byrne, 120-yard landlord, and shout-out my family.
All right, yeah. There you go, Cody Marshall. Let's do the musical chairs thing one more time. We got a couple more after that, too, I believe.
Yep.
All right. Name, number, and position.
Michael Putney, cornerback, number 6.
Michael Putney.
Yes,
I've been waiting for a while to talk to Michael Putney.
Yeah, man. You definitely earned your stripes. And kind of tell me about that state championship game. I saw a lot of people writing articles on you in that, you know, of course, if you get matched up against those Tavion Sanders, Billy Bowman, some of them are going to go their way, but a lot of the people in the press were writing really good things about you. Tell me about that state championship game, and how hard was that task to guard those guys?
How hard? Billy Bowman, he was, you know, he was hyped to, you know, like the stars. I don't feel like that matters whenever it comes down to it.
Right.
I feel like if you have that in you, you can guard anybody. And that's what, I get on the field, and that's what I think.
Right. Yeah, I didn't see Billy Bowman being mismatch to you at all. Tavion Sanders, that's a different dude. That guy's up there.
He's a grown man.
But a lot of people had a lot of good things to say about you, and you know, riding that through the off season and coming into this year, you know, it's we're really excited to see you know how this season pans out for you.
Yeah, thank you.
One time I remember in that game, Bowman got a fairly short pass in a crowd, and people fell, and he's alone and goes 50 yards for touchdown. It's probably the third quarter. I think it was the second half. And I remember looking to, since I do the stats, looking to put that in my stat sheet. And at that moment, he had had like two catches for 4 yards. So I think you guys did do a pretty good job of shutting him down for most of the day.
Yes, sir.
Vandy had some tough receivers, specifically Reese Beauchamp.
I wanted to guard him so bad. And whenever I did, I don't know if y'all seen it, but I don't think he got the ball much.
Yeah.
That tends to happen whenever I'm guarding somebody.
And so what is
we
that,
love that.
What does that mean with you? So you're a cornerback. Are you changing sides every play? Are you keying on a matchup? How does that work?
I'm trying to find the best receiver. That's who I want to guard.
Yeah.
I feel like that gives me more of like a challenge. And if I can guard them, I feel like I'm better somehow. I'm just focusing on myself.
You know, Coach, Coach let us walk the sidelines for the Westlake scrimmage, and I remember seeing at least twice – you knocked away in the end zone. What would have been two touchdown passes?
Yes, sir.
Guys that were this much taller than you.
So much. So much taller than 200 pounds.
So you've gotten really good at corner and defending passes. When did you get that? Have you always been that? Have you done other things? What have you been in your football career?
I mean, like from middle school, I was a running back. Okay. I wasn't a DB all my life. Freshman year, DB and wide receiver, and I just stuck with DB. I feel like that was something I should stick to.
Now, Cody went and caught a pass last week and played on the other side. Might you do that during the course of the season, or are you going to stick on the DB side?
I don't know. I guess I'll just let that happen. In practice, I'll see. I'm capable of it.
Will you return any kicks, maybe?
I'm hoping to do that. Freshman year, I was good at that.
Okay. Important question.
Yes, sir.
As a former receiver, who is the one receiver that you just got in practice, like on one-on-ones from our team? Who's the one that when you match up against him, you're like, I got him? Now, come on, man. Come on now.
Now, what you mean by I got him?
Like, I mean, I'm just saying back in my day,
you're
like,
gonna make this play.
Like Ryan Roberts, he was an all-state corner. But I'm telling you, in one-on-ones, I had that dude every single time. So who is the guy that you got? Lock him up.
I don't know. I'm not going to practice.
Yeah, practice. It's against our own team.
Practice against our own team.
We do this to everybody.
Because we'll ask the other question right after this.
I'm going to ask. Oh, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to say maybe Joseph.
That's right. Not getting by.
And so that other question is, which one of the receivers can burn you?
Can burn me?
Yeah.
No.
Can make the play on you consistently.
Consistent. It's never consistent. But
I
Nick,
love that.
Nick Grulion, yeah.
Grulion,
he's,
oh, that's
he's my top.
Yeah.
That's my top.
And he can jump, yeah.
Yeah.
That's
stay
cool.
Jumper.
Cool. Anybody want to give shout-outs to?
Shout-out Coach Baum. Shout-out my coaches, my family, and my McNeil boys.
All right. Yeah. That's Michael Putney, everybody. So we've got, I think, two more left, right?
Dos más.
Three more.
Musical chairs one more time. Stick around. After the next two, we'll go to a short break, and we come back. Trivia contest with the guys. All right. Name, rank, and serial number.
Luke Kaharski. I'm a safety, number 15.
Called your name out a couple times.
Definitely did.
Kaharski. Yes, sir.
So what's your spiel? What do you like to do in football?
I like to just bond with my teammates, just have fun with my friends. It's just like an extra time to hang out with them throughout the day, so – makes our friendship a lot better, a lot closer, or a lot worse.
I just got to know, but, like, I like doing that as an offensive guy. As a defensive guy, do you like to hit?
Oh, for sure.
Okay, good. Yeah, I'm just making sure. I'm just making sure. I love that everybody's a team bonder over here, but somebody's got to say violence at some point.
Violence. Bone rattling. So, Luke, what's the best hit you ever laid in high school football?
Probably just in a JV game, just like a whole shot that the quarterback tried to throw, but JV quarterbacks aren't that good, so just left the hit wide open. Yes, sir.
So are you from the Cedar Park area originally?
Yeah, I've lived here my whole life.
Nice.
Oh. What elementary school?
I went to Cypress Elementary.
Wow.
Yes, and then CPMS. Did you play for this guy?
Mm-hmm.
All right. What do you think about him as your, you know, you compare what he had to do as your coach when you're 7th and 8th grade and what he's doing now. Compare and contrast the differences there.
Well, I mean, obviously middle school, it's not as serious, and he also had to coach the quarterback, so I wasn't just fully focused on the safeties. But now that he's fully with us all the time, it's a lot more, like, intense with the coaching, a lot more competitive, and I just feel like he's there a lot more, and it's a lot, I don't know, a lot, I don't know.
Do you play any other sports still here?
No, I only play football now. Football. I stopped playing all the other sports once I got to high school.
I want to, guys, listen up, all DBs, raise your hand, and it's dark, so make sure you raise it high so I can see it, if you play baseball also.
No ballers.
Raise it if you used to play baseball until the last year or two. Wow, that's unusual. In my experience, all the defensive backs that I played for, we all played baseball too. And it seemed like that was the position on a football team that seemed to provide the most baseball players for the DBs. A little surprised to see it. None of you guys do that. They're all drag racers. So, Luke, the important question to you is, out of the defensive backs, who's the best dancer?
Probably Putt or Cody.
Mm. Oh, okay.
Both of them.
We might have a little
moves.
Post.
Like I said, we need to find some music.
We might have a dance battle over here.
Yeah, we should get it going.
Luke, what are your plans when you're done with high school?
I'm planning right now on attending Ole Miss, but I'm not sure if that's for sure. But
to study what?
Business and finance.
Co-eds.
Hey-o.
Business and finance at Ole Miss.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I guess they're pretty much underwater right now, aren't they, with the hurricane?
Yeah.
Hit them pretty bad.
It's not looking good over there.
All right, Luke Kaharski, who you got for shout now?
Shout out my family, shout out the Black Rain, and shout out all the DBs.
That's
all right,
right.
There you go. Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. Musical chairs. One more time.
Da 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 da.
Yeah, we should have had some music going.
You know, I've got some queued up for the trivia game,
two
but
more to go?
Yeah. This is the last one.
Okay. I think he said we got two more.
What?
All right, you got the mic?
No.
Name, rank, and
My name is George Wheeler. I'm number 17. I play cornerback.
George, you know, as it's gotten darker in here and the brightness of these, we can see silhouettes of bodies, shoulders, and heads, and that's it. We don't even see any faces right now.
That's what happens when you're in the bright lights.
George called your name a couple times the other night.
Yes, sir.
First varsity action?
Yes, sir.
Made a catch, didn't you?
No, I
did.
No,
you played DB only, didn't you?
Now, I did see Special Teams Player of the Week. Is that right?
Yeah, that is.
What did you do?
What do you do on Special Teams?
I'm sorry. I mean,
punt and kickoff.
Coverage, your return, both?
Punt, I made a couple tackles, and then I made a tackle on field goal block.
That's awesome.
Oh, yeah.
My roommate, my freshman year, played with me. We went to Blinn, and his name was Kyle Dwayne, had two first names, so obviously we called him Ricky Bobby.
Ricky Bobby.
But he was our wedge buster on kickoffs.
Oh,
and Coach Ross,
job.
Everybody had an assignment, and Coach Ross literally said, I don't care what this kid does. Like, he gets the football every time. He goes fast. He's Ricky Bobby. So that's good. You're being a Ricky Bobby. I like that.
George, have you always been a DB, or you just kind of migrated
that
somewhere else?
I've honestly never played offense. Even since, like, sixth grade, I was just a corner.
Are you related, by chance, to a girl named Hannah?
Yes, I am.
I wondered about that. I know your family fairly well. Greg and Karen, your folks? Hannah?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Know them well. How's Hannah doing down there at Incarnate Word? She's playing D1 basketball in San Antonio. She getting some playing time?
I think so, yeah. She plays, like, second half, I think.
Oh, well, good for her. Good for her. You ever had a chance to go down and see her play?
I've seen her play, like, one time.
Yeah.
Do you beat her one-on-one?
Yeah, can you beat her one-on-one?
No.
Bro, this is time to say yes.
But that's impressive for Hannah. I mean, she can beat her brother.
I know.
That's a damn
not
good
at basketball. Athlete. Not at basketball. Anything
that's right,
else.
That's
though.
Right. That's right.
Ah, man, that is pretty good.
Okay.
So, George, are you the youngest? Because I know there's an older sister, too, right?
I'm the youngest of three.
Youngest of three. So what are you planning to do when you're done with that? Are you a senior or a junior?
I'm a senior.
You're a senior already. I thought you were a junior. All right. What are you planning to do when high school's done?
I'm going to go to Texas Tech.
Hmm.
study like marketing or business, something like that.
Marketing and business at Texas Tech, the High Plains.
A little anatomy, I'm sure. A little question, though, for y'all are still doing morning practices, right?
Yeah, we are.
Who's the last one out?
Like, who shows up late?
What?
They're all pointing to George.
I think that one would have to be me.
Okay, I mean, I like ownership. I love taking ownership in that. Love that.
All right, George, I'll ask you this important question about the DBs. Who's the best liar?
I think that one would also have to be me.
I mean, hand up.
But that might be a lie.
Ah!
George, you got anybody for shout-outs?
Shooter Gang and Luke Smith.
Luke Smith. All right, there's George Wheeler, defensive back extraordinaire, senior.
Una mas.
And so we got one more, right?
Yes.
One more, and then we'll go to a short break and come back with our trivia.
Cool.
All right, name, rank, and serial number.
Garrett Gasley, class of 22, and number 10.
So a junior.
I know, hey. Sir. 22 is seniors.
Garrett, have you always been a defensive back?
Yes, sir, for the most part. I played a little bit of receiver early on, but, yeah, I'm pretty much stuck at defensive back right now.
And a junior, so probably JV last year, right?
Senior, yes, sir.
Oh, senior. I thought you just said you're junior.
Yes, sir.
I'm getting hard of hearing in my old age. So, you know, here you are getting to play in a big-time football program. What are some of the takeaways that a high school football player can acquire from playing in, you know, not just a football team, but a dang good football team? What are you going to take with you?
Well, you know, I certainly I learn a lot from the coaches. They're really great role models. They help us out a lot. And I learn a lot from my teammates. Just getting around and be around them and bond with them, it's really a great thing for me to go do. So, you know, sometimes it's hard to get up at 4 a.m., but, you know, whenever you get there and you see them all doing the same thing, you're like, this isn't so bad. And then you just get out there and you kind of get rolling, and, you know, there it goes for the rest of the day.
So what is your favorite thing to do away from the football field with your DB buddies?
You know, I want to say probably right now Clash Royale. we it's like a game we got on our phones. We had some nasty friendly battles for sure. So,
my God, that's sad.
Tell me.
I think maybe like me, Cody. I think George have done some fishing and stuff like that. So
yeah,
we definitely done some things like that, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
All right, you got anybody you want to give shout outs to?
Yeah, shout out Black Rain, shout out Troop, shout out my family, shout out God.
And where are you going to go when high school's done? What are you going to do with yourself?
Well, I'm looking at Texas A&M is my number one right now, and I'm going to go there for mechanical engineering.
Oh, okay. So, yeah. All right. So there you have it, folks. Our defensive back, well, our safeties coach, Brendan McCarthy, and the defensive backs with us tonight, Dylan Rogers, Dylan Hufford, Cody Marshall, Michael Putney, Luke Kaharski, George Wheeler, and Garrett Gasley. We're going to take another short break, and when we return, more nonstop honking of the Cedar Park football horn right here from Santa Catarina on Timberwolf Night in America. This is the Vipe Live Network.
You know the Alzer family. They've been involved in Cedar Park sports for years, just as Alzer's Barbecue has been involved in Cedar Park cuisine for years. It's one-of-a-kind, authentic Texas barbecue. Brisket, turkey, chicken, lamb, terrific sides and sauces. It's sheer succulence. That's Alzer's Barbecue, next to the Shell Station on 1431, just east of Lakeline. Open Friday through Sunday, every weekend.
Army Ant Moving calls Cedar Park home for movers that residents and businesses can rely on. For outstanding moving expertise and trustworthy estimates, Army Ant Moving stands above the rest. Their reputation speaks for itself. They've received the Angie's List Superior Service Award for the last 2 years. Their movers are highly trained and experienced. So whether you need to move your household to a new home across town or an entire corporate office to a new location, your valuables are in knowledgeable and reliable hands with Army Ant Moving Company. Check them out at armyantmoving.com.
A premier real estate brokerage in Central Texas, Mungia Real Estate's innovative buy-sell process results in their listings selling faster than the Austin average.
their attention to clients sets Mungia apart from other brokerages. With creative marketing strategies, savvy negotiation skills, and a commitment to hard work and excellent customer service. Whether it's residential, single-family, multifamily, condos, commercial, or vacant land, Mungia Real Estate knows the Austin market and connects buyers with sellers every day. And they do it with professionalism. Mungia Real Estate at 512-922-4267 or mungiarealestate.com. That's M-U-N-G-I-A.
Welcome back. Episode 2 of Timberwolf Night in America for 2021. Live from Santa Catarina, I'm Brad Cohn. He's John Willard. Josh Cargile, our QA tonight here on the Vibe Network, bringing you all the stuff from right here in the heart of the 613. We've been talking with our first player guests of the season, the defensive backs, and their coach, Brendan McCarthy. Here are the games for teams in our district, 11-5-AD1, during this next week. Of course, Cedar Park, 0-1, hosting 6A. Cedar Ridge, 1-0. Hendrickson, 0-1 on the road at 6A and 1-0 Belton. Georgetown's 0-1. They visit Copperas Cove. They're 0-1. Leander, 1-0. Take a picture. When's the last time the Leander Lions were 1-0?
Yeah.
They traveled to Bastrop, Cedar Creek, 0-1. Pflugerville's 1-0. They're on the road to face McNeil, who's 1-0. Battle of Unbeatens. Anderson Trojans, 0-1. They're hosting Rouse, 1-0. Manor, 0-1 on the road at 1-0. Fulshear. I had to look them up. They're from west of Katy, south of I-10.
Wow. I wonder how that matchup got scheduled.
I have no idea.
So just right out of the gate, 11-5A, not necessarily representing last week.
2-5.
We had talked
about that.
Pflugerville and the Leanderthals getting the only wins out of our district, so we got to represent a little bit better this week.
We'll win this week.
That's right. We'll do our part.
Now, as we continue to attack Josh here with three questions each Tuesday night that the National Education Agency says high school seniors should know, so you guys be thinking about these questions yourself. Here we go with tonight's three questions.
It's been 10 years, dude. I don't remember any of this stuff.
He got one of three last week, and he was going to answer one of the others correctly for two or three and change his mind at the last minute. So it's like 1.5 out of three. All right, so here's the first question. If you drank an entire cupful of hydrogen dioxide, would you be safe?
Hydrogen
dioxide. Would you be okay? Would you be okay? Would you
yes.
Be okay.
Okay. Yes.
Would be?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes is the correct answer because hydrogen dioxide is the science class name for water.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Next one.
1-1, baby.
1-1 and 2-4. Who is the current United States Secretary of State?
Oh, my gosh.
Busy making a fool of himself in the last week or 10 days.
Well, they just changed, you know, the past November. Okay, so it's almost been a year. Okay.
Current U.S. Secretary of State.
You know, I'm going to have to go a hard pass on this one.
Hard pass. That's not his name.
Okay. It was a guy. I thought it was a girl.
No, not this time. It's Anthony Blinken. That Blinken guy.
Anthony.
All right. And the last question this week. Name the four oceans in descending order of size. Remember, seniors, you're supposed to know all this stuff, too. Did you get Anthony Blinken?
Atlantic, Pacific, Indian, and Arctic.
You're close. It's Pacific, Atlantic, Indian.
Well, I was just naming them out loud to get my bearings straight.
Okay, well, then I blew it. I said descending order.
Yep. So
to get your bearings straight. I get it.
No, I was.
To get your bearings straight.
I ain't got no paper over here. I had to write this out. I got to see it.
Yeah. Okay, well
I named them, though.
You did name them quickly.
I did name them
they
correctly.
They were almost in order. You did 2, 1, 3, 4. Just switch 1 and 2 around. You would have had it. All right,
so I'm going to go ahead and give that to
you. Remember that, high school seniors, the National Education Agency says you should know all these questions that we give Josh every week.
God.
Okay, so here we go. Austin area mascots. We're going to play a relatively new version of our famous mascot game tonight. We played it each of the last 2 years. Fans of this show have often heard us pairing teams of players against each other to guess at the most used or least used team mascot names of Texas high school football programs. Tonight, something a little different. I'm going to give the names of Central Texas area schools. And you all, one team at a time, are going to try to give me that program's mascot. Some of them you'll probably consider easy, like if I said Leander.
Leander Thaws.
Yeah, the Leander Thaws. So I'm going to try to steer away from the ones that I think you might consider easy. You get a point for each one you get right. Plus, there'll be bonus points available. I'll ask two questions once we ascertain the school's mascot, whether you get it right or wrong. The questions will be, has Cedar Park ever played these guys? In football, of course. And if the correct answer to that one is yes, the next question is, have we ever beaten them? Okay, we're going to do 7 innings. Each team will get 7 shots at it, back and forth. What are the teams going to be? Hold on, let me get the names in there. Who's the team captain? Who's the team captain?
Garrett is this team's captain.
Who is? Garrett?
And Hufford is this team's captain.
Gasley and Hufford?
Yes.
Okay, Gasley's
okay.
On the side, right? Okay.
Say your last name.
Gasley? Yes, sir.
Okay,
Gasley.
See, so this is the home game this week. At the home games, Brad Cohn does the stadium announcing for all the – I do the home play-by-play. And I'm from North Carolina, so I can't really say names right. So it really helps when I hear how y'all say it.
Gasley.
Yes.
Gasley.
I don't want to mess it up in case Mom and Dad are listening. I don't want that email.
My most common missed last name with Cone, C-O-N-E, is they pluralize it, Cones.
Yeah.
More than one of them. I don't know where that comes from. Okay, so here we go. Team Gasley will be the visitors and go first. So give him the microphone. Hold the microphone away from your mouth while you're talking with them. Once you put the microphone up and say his team name, that's it. There's no change in the answer or anything like that, okay? So here's the first one, Del Valle.
Del Valle Cardinals.
That is correct. Team Gasley leads 1-0. Next question. Have we ever played Del Valle, the Cardinals?
We're going to say no.
No is the correct answer. You lead 2-0 at the top of the first inning. All right, good job.
You get my Price is Right winning horn.
He gets the Price is Right music. He gets a cheering crowd and all that. Go back and listen to it tonight on the site, and you can hear all the sound effects. All right, Team Hufford with the mic. Bottom of the first now. Here's theirs. Wimberley.
Oh, this is a good one.
Wimberley.
Yeehaw. That's my clue. That's my clue. Yeehaw.
No clues now.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Wimberley. What is the mascot for Wimberley High School?
We're going to say Texans.
You are correct. It is the Wimberley Texans. Ding,
was
ding,
it my
ding,
clue?
Ding, ding,
was
ding,
it my clue?
He said Texans right away.
Okay, good. Never mind. I thought it was my clue.
All right. Have we ever played Wimberley?
No.
No, we have not. Ding, 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 ding. We're tied 2-2 at the end of one complete inning. Bam. Top of the second. McCallum.
Knights.
Knights is the correct answer. All right. Question, have we ever played McCallum?
Yeah, we played them last year.
And have we ever beaten them?
Yes.
Yes, we've actually played them 3 times and beat them all 3 times. A solid 3-run inning in the top.
I would say all post my senior's year. I think we've played them
I think you're right.
In that latter decade.
I think you're right. McCallum Knights. When I was in high school, I went to Lanier, which is by another name these days. But in those days, it was basically just what Cedar Park High School. Same demographics and everything. And our cheerleaders, all the cheerleaders in the city, would get on K98, the big FM radio station in town, on Friday morning. K98 would have each school's cheerleaders on, and those cheerleaders would, hustle up some sort of cheer, and they get to do it on the air that morning for their game that night. So we were playing McCallum one Friday, and Friday morning I'm driving to school, and I got K98 on because I'm a teenager. And there are the Lanier Viking cheerleaders, bless their hearts. And I can't believe that they got away with this. But their cheer was, once a Viking, always a Viking, but once a night is enough. about had a wreck. Okay. All right, so it is 5-2 as we go to the bottom of the second. Team Hufford at the plate, and your team is Llano, out west of Austin, about 40 miles or so. Llano.
I actually did not know this one. That's a good one.
Tough one.
We're going to say Tigers.
Oh, first wrong answer. It's the Yellow Jackets.
Oh.
No way we're going to get that.
Yeah. Would you all have gotten that one?
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
Luck of the draw. Luck of the draw.
We're going to say.
All right. Let's see. We're going to give you the other questions anyway because we don't want them to get too far ahead.
Oh, wait. Are we going to?
So have we ever played Lano?
Yes.
No.
That's a double whammy.
They've been like 3A most of the time that we've been around.
I love the confidence. Love the confidence.
Yeah?
That was awesome.
But a defensive max confidence. Okay, next one. Team Gasly leading 5-2, going to the top of the third. And your team is Lehman down there in Kyle area. L-E-H-M-A-N. Fairly new school. 6-7 years old. Lehman. Fairly new. Maybe 6 or 7 years
you
old.
You might have to catch your next Friday football fever to get this one.
All right, we're guessing Lehman Eagles.
Not Eagles. I'm going to give you, you won't get a point for this, but I'd be interested if you get this. Our name is similar to their name.
Oh, Wolves.
Close, but it's in Spanish. Oh. Lehman Lobos. Lehman Lobos. All right. Gasly still leading 5-2, going to the bottom of the third. Oh, yeah, we'll do the bonus. No, we're only going to give the bonus question on a wrong answer to the team that's behind to try to keep
love it
from pulling too far ahead.
We're making rules as we go.
Yeah, making rules as we go. We've actually done that in other games, but not this one.
That's okay.
Okay, here we go for
you're the boss.
Team Hufford, bottom of the third, and your team is Burn It. We played in their stadium a couple years ago against the team we're about to play this week.
That was the craziest thing. It was a Thursday night that got rained out, and the closest stadium that we could get was Burn It.
Yeah.
Oh, it my
lousy,
gosh.
Lousy place. So who's Burn It?
Or that's why I locked
Burnett my, and every other
that's
state.
Why I locked my keys in the car, too.
Oh, that's right.
And I had to have the fire department come let me in. Gah.
We're going to say Bears.
Burn It Bears? That would have been good. It's not it, though.
Mm.
Burn It Bulldogs.
Ride the B. Ride the B. Okay.
Burn It Bulldogs. Yeah, a little Bulldogs. Alliteration going there. All
like
right,
it.
So have we ever played Burn It?
Yes.
No. Never played. They've been 3A most of the time.
Wow.
Okay, so still, nobody's scored in 3 half innings.
All righty.
Top of the fourth now. We go to Team Gasly, still leading 5-2.
Might have to start giving them some softballs.
And your team is Hayes.
Is this
down south? Same school district as Lane.
Is this pre-cancel culture or post?
Pre-cancel culture. You're right. Hayes Rebels. Okay, have we ever played the Hayes Rebels?
Oh, have we?
Yes, we have.
We have.
Back in my day, we used to.
Have we beaten them?
Yes.
Yeah.
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 We played
take
them
that clue.
5 times, but we barely lead 3-2. We lost the first two. We beat them ever since. All right. So a full 3 points here in the top of the fourth.
Do you remember when we played at Hayes and the lights went out?
Yeah.
That was crazy.
8-2. Our
can
scores.
We
go to the.
Father's not allowed.
We go to the bottom of the fourth now for Team Hufford, and your team is Taylor.
Okay.
Northeast of here on 79. Taylor.
What was the question?
Taylor.
We're going to say Ducks.
Love
Taylor
it.
Ducks is correct.
Okay. Comeback season, baby.
All right, have we ever played the Taylor Ducks?
I don't think so.
You are correct. We have not.
Okay.
2 points.
Man.
8-4 now, Gasly. Team Gasly is up in the top of the fifth. And your team is Crockett High School in South Austin. Crockett. Davy Crockett High. They're not the raccoons. It should have been. It should have been. Crockett. The Crockett Crooks. The Crockett Dials.
That would be good.
Or anything we're saying, like ringing a bell or
not. Give us an answer. You got anything?
Crockett Rangers.
Good guess.
Don't give Vista Ridge anything.
It's more alliteration.
Come on.
Crockett Cougars. Crockett Cougars.
The Cougs.
So it's still 8-4, Team Gasly. Team Hufford at the bat. And your team is Cedar Creek, Bastrop Second High School, Cedar Creek.
Shout out Alfred Collins, going to do work for Texas this year.
Cedar Creek Eagles.
Down there on 71, I guess it is. What is it, Cedar Creek Eagles?
Yes, sir.
You are correct. It is the Cedar Creek Eagles. Have we ever played the Cedar Creek Eagles?
Yes.
Have we beaten them?
Yes.
3 points for Team Hubbard. They close the gap.
A winner.
Score now 8-7. Gasly with three complete innings to go. Gasly at the plate. Gasly. Gasly. Gasly at the plate in the top of the sixth inning. With two innings to go, yeah. And your team? Lampasas.
We're saying Badgers.
Badgers is correct.
Love it.
Have we ever played the Lampasas Badgers?
They have a cool stadium.
They do now.
All right, we're rolling with no.
We did. We were in our district the first year we were ever in any district. Beat them both times.
Hate to see it.
Stretch your lead to 2 points. They've got one more at-bat left than you do.
We need all 3 points.
Team Hufford at the plate. San Marcos.
Oh.
Rattlers.
Rattlers is correct. Have we ever played the San Marcos Rattler?
We have, right? There is a way, bro. We
just
didn't play them.
Yes.
We have played them. Yes. Oh, really? When?
We beat them when they were ranked number 7 in the state.
Okay.
And they had a big UT signee, a big defensive end that was all state. And Quentin Smith ran over his ass for 278 yards.
Cute. This was my hero when I was a young lad.
We won that game.
Yes, we won that game big time.
That's 3 points.
Like 38-3 or something like that.
Dude, that's
when the game.
That's when the wishbone was the wishbone.
Oh, well, we're not done quite yet with the game.
Oh, okay.
But you're leading by one.
Leading by one.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Wait.
You said they were down 2 going into that one.
Yeah, hold on. I got 3 on there. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 9. Yes, you lead 10-9, and here is the last at bat.
Oh, this is the last question.
Yep.
Oh, you get one more after.
Yeah, they're the visitors. Okay. You get the last bat.
You're home.
Yeah, and you won't get it if they don't score here because you're ahead. All right, 10-9. You.
Golly.
And Team Gasly, here we go.
This is killing me.
Oh my gosh, this is going to be a tough one.
We've narrowed.
It's right there.
Yeah.
Florence.
Oh.
Florence. I always said Florence is the home of the Fighting Hendersons. Hey, these guys won't get that one.
Dude, I don't even know where Florence is.
Florence on the way from Georgetown to Copper's Cove. They've had a few, they're a small school, they've had a few deep playoff runs. And it's not the Nightingales. I think they should have named their women's team the Nightingale.
All right, I need an answer.
All right, got an answer? You drew probably the toughest one right when you didn't need it.
We're rolling with Florence Armadillos.
Oh, man,
love it. Love the effort.
Close.
Love that effort.
Buffaloes. Florence
the
Buffaloes. So, ding, 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 ding. Team Hufford, a comeback win, 10-9.
We'll just give them this one just for fun.
All right, let's see if we can get the last one.
Okay.
All right, we got 2 we could give. Which one do you want to give?
Give us the hardest one.
The hardest one.
Well, then that one.
Yeah. Okay, hardest one is Granger.
Go ahead,
like
Dylan.
2A. I had a nephew that played for Granger. He was awful, and he started at tight end.
When I was the king of laces
my
kicker's name was Granger. Granger McCullough. A.K.A. Shooter.
Granger. Who's Granger? It's up there north and east of Georgetown, 15, 18 miles.
If you don't get this right, minus 3 points, and they win. I'm just kidding.
Any guesses?
The Granger Titans.
Granger Lions.
Oh, that bogey kind of close.
Not really.
Good. All right. A 10-9. Yeah, long I. Two syllables, long I. S at the end.
Yeah,
he's close.
It was
there
close.
You go.
All right. Well, good game. Good game. Close one. 10-9.
Good game, guys.
8-3 deficit. All right. Okay. Oh, I had a tiebreaker question if it ended up in a tie. Let's say it was a tie. First team to shout out the right number here would win the tiebreaker.
You can put it down.
Yeah. How many before I do that, let me list the teams in, because some of them we didn't get to. They were extras. Del Valle, Wimberley, McCallum, Llano, Lehman, Burnett, Hayes, Taylor, Crockett, Cedar Creek, Lampasas, San Marcos, Gerald, Lockhart, Lago Vista, Austin High, Granger, and Florence. Okay, now, of all those teams, how many state championships do all of those teams have between them?
Zero. Two.
Zero and two. Two's closer. Four. Austin High won the state title in 1942. Wimberley won it in 05 and 11. Granger won it in 97.
That was a good year.
I actually called play-by-play on a radio, statewide radio broadcast of Granger's state title game.
Wow. That's cool.
Austin High in 42. Yeah.
Okay.
Wimberley in 05 and 11. And Granger in 97.
Okay.
All right. Preview of Cedar Ridge, our last item. After a quick look at them, we're going to cede most of this segment to our defensive backs coach. Cedar Ridge went 6-4 last year, lost big to eventual state champ Westlake in the first round of the playoffs at like 54-17 or something. This will be the fourth meeting ever between our two programs, the previous three all coming in the last 3 years. We lead the series 2-1, falling 34-28 in game two of 2018, the one played out in Burnett where Josh locked the keys out of his car.
Mm.
A lousy stadium, a lousy night. We lost the game, and you locked your keys in the car.
You know.
That was a lousy night.
It was in threes. It was in threes that night.
Now, we won the next two, 26-14 at home in 19, and last year, 28-14 at the Palmer Palace. They're currently 1-0, 45-14 win over Killeen, Texas football. Picks them to finish third in 26-6A behind Vandy and Round Rock. So, Coach, from the perspective of your defense and defensive backs specifically, what are the keys going to be for them Friday night? Oh, hold on.
Keep going.
There you go.
They have a big tight end H-back that he's very physical. They like to run behind, and they'll throw to him as well. So we got to try to stop him the best that we can. He's obviously talented. They have another outside receiver that they'll put in at quarterback every once in a while, and he's really, really fast. So, you know, you got a game plan for him to be on the outside as well as that quarterback. And then they have, you know, other receivers too that can do it too. So it'd be a good challenge for us. I think, you know, when we're looking forward towards it, you know, from going from last week to this week, I think they've had a really good week of practice. I mean, it's a challenge they're up for. You know, they have a couple running backs that can go. So, I mean, they're a talented team, you know, and, you know, 6A team out of Round Rock. So, you know, they're going to be good. And
I don't like the fact that they scored, 45 again last week. Looks yeah. like a scary offense to me.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's a challenge. It's a challenge our boys are up to. And I think they're looking forward to it. And
to be back home again.
Going to be back at home at Gupton, you know, so that's always a plus. And like I said, they're looking forward to it. They've had a great week of practice. Got another one tomorrow, and I think they'll be ready to go.
All right. Thanks, Coach. And, you know, this is homecoming already.
Yeah.
First game of the year is homecoming. It's quite a homecoming. I mean, I think our last time to play a home game was the first round of the playoffs in December. So it's a pretty long wait for the homecoming break.
That's right. It's been a long time coming.
Josh, any final remarks before we go?
Oh, just excited to get this week going. You know, wasn't here at the beginning of the broadcast, but just kind of my takeaways from last week's game, and just don't look at that scoreboard. I know it was a daunting, you know, difference in that score,
yeah.
But at the same token, I felt like our players were in the right position to make plays offensively, hold on to the ball and ball security, and we might be up going into halftime in that game. So I think just getting the offseason jitters, getting into the mix now, getting into game week, game planning and getting into that normal routine for a game week is going to get this team on the right track. So I'm excited to see how this Timberwolf team responds to that last week loss against Vandergrift, because it's not going to get any easier through non-district. It's only going to probably get harder. Round Rock is a very physical and big team as well. Cedar Ridge is a very big and physical team. So it's going to be a great measuring stick for our guys to just trust in the plan, buy into the system, and just control what you can control. Don't worry about what everybody else is doing. Just focus on your role and how you can be a vital asset to this team in getting the common goal of a victory. So I'm excited to see this team take the field again, because I know that y'all are chomping at the bit to get back out there after last week's game, because that's not what we're trying to portray, and I know that's not what y'all are trying to portray. It's this team has a lot of hard work that they've gone through the offseason to get to this moment, so I know that they're ready to right the wrong and get back out there and just go play Timberwolf football.
This is the kind of game that my high school coach, C.L. Hawker, would call a mouthwash game.
Yes. Yes.
Warrants the taste out of your mouth.
But, I mean, and that's the thing, too. You have those kind of games, then you get back into the lab, work hard during the week, so then you're excited for that next opportunity to get on the field as a team and a unit to compete. So I know that these guys are going to take full advantage of that opportunity.
All right, once again, the Booster Club sponsors and the sponsors of this broadcast, Toyota Cedar Park, HEB, Rudy's Barbecue, Alzer's Barbecue, Mungia Real Estate, and our touchdown sponsor, TJ Lewis Real Estate. Hope to call his name out a lot at the stadium Friday night. We call out TJ Lewis every time we score a touchdown. Army Ant Moving, Wofford Bank, and of course, Santa Catarina Mexican Restaurant. That's it for our second episode of Timberwolf Night in America for the 2021 season. Friday night, the team's home opener as they take on another tough 6A opponent, Cedar Ridge Raiders. Kickoff at 7 at the Gup. Pregame show 6:45. I'll host the pregame, halftime, and postgame shows. Josh will have play-by-play. Cecil with technical production and commentary. And Nathan Moschel with his return to the camera work. Timberwolves working on a 17-game home winning streak that extends back to the early part of 2018. Thanks to our guests tonight, DBs and their coach, Brendan McCarthy, Dylan Rogers, Dylan Hufford, Cody Marshall, Michael Putney, Luke Gaharski, George Wheeler, and Garrett Gasley. For our QA, Josh Cargyle, and for my own personal Chris Collinsworth, Josh Willard. This is Brad Cohn signing off. You've been listening to Timberwolf Night in America on the Viper.